Welcome back to the Enterprise App Pattern series of videos. In this particular video, we're going to talk about the security pillar of the reliable web app pattern. My name is Matt Soka. All right, for security, I don't need to tell you that security is of a paramount concern. Doesn't matter if the app is public facing, if it's just internal facing, security is important. But what's cool is that the cloud, that Azure can implement and provide advanced security practices. It kind of steers you in the way that you should go. So security is, first off, all about several things. One, confidentiality, integrity, and availability of both your application and of your data. You want to make sure your data stays confidential. You want to make sure it's good, that you know that the data hasn't been messed with or tampered with. And you also want to make sure that your app and everything is available, that your data can be served. All right. So security itself has a couple different components that the reliable app pattern tells us how to implement. And the first is managed identity. So managed identity is like a secure connection between different Azure resources, but without the need for a connection string or a password. So think about making an Azure resource an entity within Azure Active Directory. We can make it like Matt, and then we can grant Matt access to different resources as well by using RBAC control. So the principle of least privilege applies to managed identity. So, which brings us to identity-based authentication. So we're granting services access based on their identity. So it doesn't necessarily need to be services. It could be things like Matt, or it could be our app service granting access to a SQL server. So we're based off of which identity it is, granting access to it, and obviously we want to grant as little amount of access as possible. And then another principle that reliable web app pattern helps us guide us on is secret management. Now, secret management is all about Azure Key Vault to store the secrets. Now, Key Vault is industry-leading way to store secrets. And you can also use identity-based authentication to get at secrets as well. And also endpoint security. So what I like about endpoint security is that it introduces networking constraints. So for example, the reliable web app pattern, when we deploy it with the is production flag set, it completely seals off SQL Server and the Redis cache resources from the public internet, meaning you couldn't access them from outside of Azure at all. Only the two app services can get at them. All right, so let's see managed identity and identity-based authentication in action in both our code and in the Azure portal. So I have the program class of the web API open here. And the thing I want to point out is the default Azure credential class. So what this is doing, I'm using the Azure Identity SDK and then passing that when I connect, in this case to Azure App Configuration, I'm passing it the default Azure credential, which is a part of the Azure Identity SDK. And what that's doing is that that's looking down several different ways to see how it can connect. Now, what I mean by this is when I'm running locally in Visual Studio, it's going to use Matt as my Active Directory credentials to connect to. However, when I have this code deployed up to App Service, it's going to use App Service's managed identity to connect to. So, long way of saying, default Azure credential is a smart way of knowing who is running the code and how to connect to Azure. So it's a nice class to have in your code. All right, so Azure App Service, as I mentioned before, can be run with a managed identity. And here's how you would check that out. I'm going to open up the API App Service itself. I'm going to type in identity over on the left side. When that comes up, I can see both a system assigned identity and a user assigned identity. The system-assigned identity and user-assigned identity are both managed identities. There's a slight difference between the two. This app service happens to have a user-assigned identity to it. The difference between system-assigned and user-assigned managed identities is, the big one is that user-assigned managed identities can be shared across different resources. And they're also able to be deleted when you delete the resource group and so on. However, for our purposes, you can see that right here, there's a user-assigned identity called web-randomstring-identity. When I open that up, and I look at the Azure role assignments, I can see that this has been granted app configuration data reader to the Relay Cloud resource group. So what that means, when I open up my app configuration instance, and I look at the access control, and then I look at the role assignments, I can see the app configuration data reader is that web account from before. Now, here's what's nice about it. We're limited. That web account could have been set to app data owner, but it's not. It was only set to app data reader. So we abided by the principle of least privilege. And so it was the same thing for me. If you saw before the role assignments, my account's in there, and again, just app configuration data reader. So by using that default Azure credential that we saw in the code, both me and the web API can use the same code to use the same managed identity resource grouping configuration to get at code. So we're not using the same managed identity, but rather we're using the same code to get to how we get RBAC access to it. And there's another thing I want to talk about, and that's secret management. And you can do that with Azure Key Vault, and actually you can put Azure App Config on top of that as well. So first off, let's take a look here. And as you can see, there are little app key icons everywhere for things that actually go back to Key Vault. When I click on it, and I say edit, I could select the Key Vault and then pick a secret from there if I wanted to. So that is a way I could relate my app config back to Key Vault. And what's nice about that, in the code, I could get at values in Key Vault just by the same way as I was get at a regular value in app config. But you'll notice right here, back in the program file for the web API, I'm doing a Key Vault, configure Key Vault, and then set credential, and also passing the default Azure credential to that. So what I'm saying here is, just because my code might have read access to app config, it doesn't necessarily mean I have access to Key Vault. I have to grant that separately. So if I do open up the Key Vault itself, and then I look at access policies, I want to be sure that my managed identity has access to the secrets contained within it. Then one last thing I want to talk about is endpoint security, or closing off access to certain Azure resources from the public internet. Now, one thing that we can do is close Azure SQL Server off from the internet completely. So I'm going to go down and open Azure SQL Server up. Type in networking over on the left-hand side. And we're going to look at a couple values here. On the public access side, I have, instead of taking public network access off completely, I do have selected networks. And by having selected public networks, that means I could add my personal, set up some firewall rules, and add my client IP address in there if I wanted to do some local development on it. But I could disable public network access altogether and completely set it off. One thing I do have is an exception on it, and saying, you know what, let's allow other Azure services to have access to it additionally. And so what this says is, hey, you know what, let's have the Azure App Service API be able to talk to SQL Server. Cool. So nobody else can talk to SQL Server right now. We do have a private endpoint set up for that, so things within the endpoint itself can be used to talk to SQL Server. But also, I want to show you how, even though nothing is set up, I would get refused to talk to SQL Server right now, my Azure App service can talk to it. So the first thing I want to do is actually go out and get the keys for SQL Server. I want to know what the IP address of it is. So I'm going to look at the connection string, and it's this address. Then I'm going to open up the API app service. So from here, I can go to diagnostic and solve problems. Scroll down to troubleshooting, diagnostic tools, and then network connectivity troubleshooter. I want to check connection issues. And so here what I'm making sure is that my web API can connect to SQL Server, showing off that even though it was disabled from all outward connections, I could still get it internally from it. All right, so once that comes up, I can paste in the network TCP address along with its port, and then hit continue. And what it's going to do is going to see if it can access it. And it says that it can. Connected, and everything's good. Great. So even though I couldn't access it from the outside, I can access it from within Azure. Effectively, my Azure SQL Server is locked down, at least a bit more secure than it was before. So you saw some implementations of security best practices as given to us from the Reliable Web App Pattern, including managed identity, identity-based authentication, secret management, and endpoint security. So if you want to know more information about it, feel free to head out to the Reliable Web App GitHub website and read up on the documentation. Again, my name is Matt Sokup, and I look forward to talking to you more about cost optimization in the next video.